Okay. Dr. Henry Lee requires no introduction. He is regarded as the top forensic scientist in the US and in the world. Okay. He has already retired, but he has always been very willing to come forward to give talks and presentations to further knowledge in the field of forensic science. Okay. We are very fortunate today to have Dr. Lee here and also Mrs. Lee. They're both here today. They just came into Singapore. They just came into Singapore on Friday on invitation of the Singapore Police Force. All right, and I understand that Dr. Lee is leaving Singapore tomorrow. Right, so for just here for 4 days, and he has kindly agreed to give you all a presentation to share in his life and experiences and some of the cases which he has done, right, over the past 4 decades. Right, so without much further ado, may I invite Dr. Lee.
Well, thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be here, to be with you. But not like Eugene say, I come voluntarily, because he and Stella twist my arm to come here. But of course, this is the second time I visit your university now. It's so nice to see a lot of young people here. I'm going to spend the first maybe 20 minutes to share some of my life experience with you. Then we're going to talk about, because that's a biological science, we're going to talk a little bit about biological science, DNA. Then we're going to rest of the time talk some famous cases. If you have any question or any request, if you want to hear certain cases, just raise your hand. I did bring my computer, and inside probably have 6,000 different cases. So we can spend a whole year here talking about biological science. Not too long ago in the United States, they gave me another award. That award they call Alice Allen Award. Alice Allen Award is given to somebody. It's not a U.S. citizen, wasn't born in U.S., but U.S. citizen, and made some contribution to the country and to the world. In the United States, usually every week I receive an award. So it's not the sort of, at the early days when I received the first or second award, very exciting. But after a while, just all head. So I did not really, you know, get too excited until I got there, see the Marine Band, Air Force Color Guard, Navy Flag Guard, the President flew in with helicopter, and they gave me a medal, a gold medal, so heavy, the whole night I can't even lift my head. They say a lot of nice things about me. Say, I touched the life of all. From the poor to the presidents of the nations. I did investigate quite a few. President Kennedy assassination. Of course, you know Clinton and, you know that case, okay? So I give you a award for knowing that. Catch. All right, give her a hand. This is my badge. The commissioner's badge. A lot of people think this badge is a protector. Protect you from an evil spirit. Because I work around the world, probably 8,000 some cases. I never have bad dreams, and I touch a lot of bodies. Never got sick, So they think I must have some magic protector. And so they think this is the magic protector, especially in China. The Chinese police officer dying for this thing. In the United States, on eBay, it's $49.99 now. Because one time I have a car accident. Have four people in the vehicle. The vehicle rolled on a hill. Three died, one survived. Police ask him, how did that happen? He said, I have Dr. Lee's protector. And so eBay is $49.99. Someday when I die, this is going to worth more money, okay? And so if you answer correctly, you get that badge. All right, if you answer half correctly, you get the autographed picture. That's also worth $14.99 now. So if nobody answered them, nobody got anything. If you answer get wrong, what are we going to do? You get a kiss from Eugene. All right. So I have to say something back to thank them. I say, anybody can read that? Okay. Your turn. Excellent. Wow. Where does she come from? You must be from China, right? Okay, you're cheating. From her pronunciation, I know she comes from China. I even can predict what province. And so, what means, I only did one thing in my life. Is make impossible become possible. All right? You like that. Okay, since you like it, I give you a... You like it too?
Yes, sure.
So each one have half. All right. So, what does it mean? All my life, as you probably know, everybody's life have up and down. Don't expect your life go to smooth, so smooth. You're going to have up and down and up and down. When you're up, don't forget. Don't get too overjoyed. When you are low, don't give up either. So every day, just make sure, work hard, so-called walk a step. But that step, you should leave an impression. After a year, you look back, you have walked a lot of steps, left a lot of impression. That's so important in our life, is make impossible possible. In my life, a lot of time people tell me, that's impossible. This is a very common phrase in the United States. Anytime you have an idea or something, people tell you, that's impossible. Don't give up. Make impossible possible. That make you unique. I was born in China in a small village. Never in my life dream now work around the world. My father passed away when I was so young. My mother raised all 13 brothers, sisters, 13 children. I'm the second youngest one. A lot of people that time tell my mother, impossible for a widow to raise that many kids. My mother did that. And make sure we all finish our terminal degree. That's why people ask me who you respect the most. I said, my mother. Who is the greatest person in the world? I said, my mother. Who you scared the most? I said, my mother. So my mother really make my life complete different, make it possible, become impossible. During revolution, we have to run to Taiwan. My father died, so went to Taiwan. Now a lot of writer in United States, a movie producer, even television anchorman cover my story, always say, when I was young, I want to become the world best known detectives. No, that's bullshit. When I was young, I want to become a basketball player. Honestly, when I was high school, I'm pretty quick. And one day I even made an appointment to see the coach. He looked at me and said, son, will you grow another 2 feet, come back to see me. I took literally every night try to do exercise, hopefully squeeze a couple more inches out of me. Then one night I realized I don't have Kobe Bryant's chromosome. I don't have Yao Ming's DNA. How can I become 7 feet tall? Impossible. I realized each of us have a physical limit, have a mental limit. So if you know your ability, then you can make impossible possible. So we're family so poor, I cannot pay the ordinary university college tuition. Only two universities in Taiwan, it's free. One is the military academy, the second is the police college. So I become a police officer. Which one is me? Huh? Some say left, some right. Who said the most handsome one? Raise your hand. That's me. The most handsome one, right? So I become the youngest police captain. Over time in Taiwan, the police college, when you graduate, they give you a law degree. They give you a black belt. I wear my black belt today. So don't have any fancy move, okay? I have a black belt. And also give you a lieutenant bar. If you are number one or number two in the class, they quickly promote you. So I cheated on all my exam. And when I was 22 years old, I became one of the youngest police captain in Taiwan history. So after 5 years working in the police department, I realized I have to study more. Because early days, how we solve the case, we just run up a usual suspect and tier one confess. If nobody confess, what do? Bring them to the back room. 5 minutes later, everybody confess. Each person makes 7 confessions. Our clearance rate is 150%. We clear more cases than actual cases. Of course, many innocent people was forced into confession. That's why I decided to go to U.S. to study. Everybody tell me that's impossible. I said, police officer, we use instinct. We use feeling. I can walk on the street, look at somebody, I know this person is a crook or not. I can look at the classroom, who is a good student, who is a bad student. Every time I look at my kids, they start confess. I did not even ask the question, they start confess. That's called instinct. I said, scientist, you have to put your feeling, your instinct away. Use logic. To totally objective, use scientific evidence, approach the issue. I decide to go to United States to study. Middle of the night, I'm still doing an experiment. You have to make impossible possible. I start from freshman again. Then finish my master's degree, my PhD in molecular biology, actually in biological science. That's why I come here, right? That's a biological science department. Not many of you. Why? What kind of biological science you guys study? Nobody knows? Chemistry. Biochemistry. That's what I'm my master's degree in. Who said biochemistry? Almost. Biochemistry. So I'm really lucky met that time the most famous biochemist in the world, Savaro Ochoa. Dr. Savaro Ochoa, he received Nobel Prize for his contribution, develop the genetic code. You know DNA, right? From DNA to messenger DNA, messenger DNA to protein. So the protein have a triplet code from messenger to protein. Dr. Ochoa is the one of the person discovered that. So I'm really lucky to work for him as a technician. That means he took me in as a student. So my thesis actually is initiation factor, how the protein gets started, initiate, how it was shut down, and termination factor. Then we found out that time in 1960, the enzyme basically followed the model key and the lock. In other words, one enzyme, one function. However, we found out the initiation factor have two functions. When you have too much of an initiation factor, the protein biosynthesis is shut down. That became a very important discovery. So he got the Nobel Prize, I got the PhD. And so then I joined, after I graduated, joined a forensic laboratory in Connecticut. And of course, worked a lot on crime scene. And in 1998, the governor wanted me to be the commissioner for Connecticut State Police. I turned him down. I said, no, I don't want it. I said, former governor asking me, I tell him I don't want it. Last governor asking me, I said, walk on my dead body. Because I don't want to be a chief and somebody in charge. I just want to work in the laboratory, work in the crime scene. That make me happy. So this governor pretty smart. He called my mother. So my mother said, what do you mean you don't want it? I said, I don't want to. Mom, that's a job. Do you know what that job means? I have to have 17 meetings a day. I have to learn, hug the lady, kiss the baby. And because in the United States, the commissioner, if I walk into this, let's say this auditorium, if you guys get up, I shake my hand, I have to shake your hand, give you a hug, and try to close to the community, the public, right? That's a politician supposed to do. And my mom said, you take a job, it's not for yourself. It's what can you service? What can you do for the society, for the people? Also, she said, you have to break the glass ceiling. Because in the United States, in our history, never have a minority or female become a state police commissioner. Usually it's a macho guy, have to be 6'2", 280 pounds, smoke a big cigar, speak English nobody even understand. That's a commissioner, right? Have two big guns, that sort of thing. I'm the shortest commissioner. After two terms, I really missed Forest Exercise. I restored the public confidence on the law enforcement, implement all this new idea, project, even an 800 megahertz radio system so you can communicate and DNA data bank, sex offender data bank. So after two terms, I said I did everything I promised. It's in good shape. I should leave now. Then governor said, well, you have to pick one, the successor. The final candidate, 17 of them, I pick a superior court judge. So the day he swear in, I said, the reason I pick you, Judge Spada, not because your legal knowledge, not because your ethics standard. I said, the only reason I pick you, because you're shorter than me. I said, I don't want to go down the history, U.S. history. I'm the shortest state police commissioner. I'm the second shortest one. My mom said, you know, so many Chinese officers, actually about 5,000 minority, say Indian, Chinese, and Asian police officer, but always never reach high rank. It's basically in the lower level. She said, you have to break these glass ceilings. We Asian also can become a commissioner. So my mom is a really smart man, a smart lady. Anyway, better than my man, but my mom actually, I think she also my father too. And she really served a dual role, father and mother, for so many years. Recently, they select 10 most famous forensic scientists in the world from 18th century to 21st century. So when they notify me, the first thought, I'm very happy. Why a Chinese guy become number one, right? Then when I look at it, 5 out of 10 already passed away. Professor Jefferson Bill from England, the famous pathologist, 1837, already passed away. Professor Lacar passed away. My good friend, Professor Mabel, passed away. And I said, holy smokes, that's a message for me. Number six, I'm going to be gone. So I wrote a letter saying, thank you, no thanks, you take your award back unless you give some different order. And the organizer said, well, Dr. Wack is 31. He's going to pass away before you. And Dr. Bada, your good friend, also going to go before you. I said, okay, tell myself that. And a lot of people ask me how I opened the door in the United States. I said, pretty simple. What does it mean? Work harder. Okay? In the U.S., only two ways open the door. Either you have a last name, Kennedy, Rockefeller, or Gates, or somebody, or you work hard. And so I decided to choose the second way, work hard. As a matter of fact, any company, anything, any industrial or university or research, you have to continue moving. I got my first doctor degree. I have to work three jobs. Work at the NYU Medical Center as a technician. I have to wait on table every night make extra money to pay the tuition to support my family, then I have to teach Kung Fu and Karate Weekend. I have a black belt. And so I got my doctor degree. Turn out in United States, everything costs money, including your own graduation. Commencement, you have to pay. I don't have money to pay. I graduated myself in my living room. So my daughter said, Daddy, Daddy, meet the witness. So she put the giraffe next to her. A lot of people say I make impossible possible. I'm from a police officer, become a PhD in molecular biology. Never heard of it. And now it's so easy. I give 30-minute commencement speech. They give me a doctor degree. I was in St. John's. I shared this with the student. I said, three types of people in the world. Some people make things happen. Some watch things happen. Where others wonder what has happened. Is that true? You guys are the first group of people. Today you come here. Nobody put the gun next to you, your head. You have to listen to Dr. Lee's talk. I know Stella says, if you don't come, you flunk. Right? You're the first group. You want to learn something from me. Make things happen. You can goof off, take a nap, or some can go drink a beer, play some cards. You watch things happen. The saddest group of people is the world has changed now. They don't even know what has happened. So after my talk, I get a couple more doctor degrees. They give me a Doctor of Human Letters, Doctor of Medicine, Doctor of Science, Doctor of Engineering, Doctor of Business. I don't even sing. They want to give me a Doctor of Music. Actually, I have a Doctor degree of Law. Williams Law School gave me this. Oh, that's Doctor of Engineering. They want me to talk about time management. I said, God treated everybody equal. We all have 24 hours a day. In a year, you only have 8,760 hours. In the United States, average people working 1,600 hours a day. That's good worker. Because they have to take 1 hour lunch break, 30-minute morning coffee break, 30 minutes of afternoon break, then some people cheating, goes to men's room for 20 minutes, reading papers, and at 4 o'clock, time to go home, 3:30, they clean up the table, and you are actually cheating yourself. Most average people sleep about 3,200 hours a year, eat and drink 1,000 hours. Of course, we Asians have to eat more hours. We spend more hours on the table. Meaningful chore, 730 hours. And waste of time, 2,000 hours. I don't like to waste the time, so I save every minute. I eat fast. You witness, I eat so fast. My wife sometimes gets so upset. She haven't finished cooking, already finished eating. She said, I'm a vacuum machine. I sit down, gone. I sleep less. So in a year, I can save a lot of hours. If that much an hour, you can do anything. You can learn music, you can practice calligraphy, painting, or biochemistry, or anything. You're going to achieve a little bit more than others by hard working. So after finish, I get more degree. that's a doctor degree of law. They want me to talk in Chinese. That's in China. All right? That's what they say. Anybody else can understand that? Wow, that many. Oh. All right. Stella, you select one. You want to, okay, translate. Translate that in English. Oh, a lot of, who want to do that? You want to do that? Yeah, try, don't worry about it. Get up, say something, don't worry about it. Okay, pretty good. Okay, that's your bike. Catch. Hey, you're supposed to catch. I am pretty good. In other words, I encourage young people to drink. A lot of professors tell young people, don't drink. If you don't have today's dream, you don't have tomorrow's reality. Dream. Set the goal. So continue working towards your goal. If you have that, then you have determination, you have energy, and you can achieve. So after that, get more doctorate degree. Recently, they asked me to talk about why I'm so successful. Actually, a lot of failure nobody knows. And I said, master of success, have knowledge and courage in your mind. You have to have knowledge. Doesn't matter what you do. The particular area you choose as your career, have knowledge. Then you have courage to follow through. But have strength and health in your body. If you have knowledge, but your body, you don't have energy and health. That's why live a healthy life. It's important. Have honesty and passion in your heart. So after that, get more doctorate degree. Now I think I have a 25 or 28 honorary doctorate degree now. Don't worry about it, so get another doctorate degree. Talk about manage your life. You need knowledge, you need leadership, vision, experience, and hard work. So I started University in New Haven in 1975 after I got my doctorate degree. That time, I only have two students. A convert laboratory. No equipment. People tell me impossible. Even my professor, advisor, my boss, Dr. Ochoa, I say, I only took few students. Berkeley offer you a job. Michigan State offer you a job. You should go there. Why you pick University New Haven? 3 years later, he said, you did the right thing. If I go to Berkeley, everybody work hard. I'm probably still an assistant research professor. You probably have the feeling here, the university here, everybody work hard. You're just one of the million, right? University in New Haven is so small, in 3 years, I became tenured professor and chairman. These two students, later on, become the world famous forensic scientists. Both of them retired. I'm still working. One become an assistant director for FBI. Now we, our university in New Haven program, have 59 different country people attend. Of course, we have two beautiful people from Singapore, and Stella and Eugene, and of course, our institute now become the crime scene, National Crime Scene Training Center, also become a National Cold Case Center. We do a lot of work. That's our new institute. And inside have touch screen, artificial intelligence, and a lot of equipment. Also, we teach a lot of workshops, and we have a lot of most advanced 3D ABS equipment. We do a lot of reconstruction, and it's interesting, a lot of exciting work. In 1976, the former governor invited me for lunch. I got my doctorate degree, I still remember that. My boss, Ochoa, called me into his office. "Congratulations, Dr. Lee. Start tomorrow. You're no longer a technician." As his technician, I got more money. In 1974, he pays me $19,000 a year. But that time, it's good money, $19,000. He said, "You have to quit your job." I said, "Well, I just graduated, I got fired." He said, "I like you so much, I want you to be my postdoc." I said, thank you so much. But as a postdoc, in 1974, how much did they pay you? Anybody have any idea? Huh? $10,000? Less. $6,000. Usually $5,000, $4,000 to $5,000. Since he liked me, he gave me $6,000. So I got home, tell my wife, I said, "Good news." She said, "What?" I said, "Friend, now on you can address me Dr. Lee. The bad news, we'll have to live on $6,000. So I joined University of New Haven. In a couple of years, I make $35,000. So I feel pretty good. I went, have lunch with governor. I tell my wife, "Press my suit." She said, "You only have one." I said, "Press harder, right? I want to impress governor." So she talked me into become the first chief criminalist for state Connecticut. She created that job. Also become director for Connecticut State Police. Guess what? How much I make as chief? $19,000. So I got home, tell my wife, "Good news." She said, "What's the good news?" I said, "Tomorrow you can address me chief." I'm back to what I like, forensic science. She said, "How much are you making now?" I said, $19,000. She said, "Why don't you stay put to teach at university?" I have a dream. I want to build the best laboratory. So when I joined the laboratory that time, I only have 19 people work for me. They're either disabled or troublemaker. No place to put. I have two sergeants, one captain as my deputy. My document examiner, handwriting expert, have an eye problem. I said, "Murph, you can't even see. How can you become a document examiner?" He said, "I don't know. I cannot patrol." The commissioner said, "Okay, you cannot patrol. Become a document examiner." That's a slot, vacant slot. Transfer him. My voice print guy, 1 year work. My serologist, even worse. Anytime see something red, he starts shaking. And I did not give up on them. They did not give up on me. I took them all back to university, retrained. The document examiner cannot see. I said, "How about your year?" "Oh, Dr. Lee, my year is good." I said, "You become a voice print expert." And the voice guy cannot hear. I said, "How about your eyesight?" "Oh, excellent, 20-20, 20-20. I said, "Now you become a document examiner." And my serologist, I don't know what to do with him. So finally, I said, "Mental discipline. you just change the red to blue. Anytime you see something red, you just pretend that's blue. Sure enough, he's not shaking anymore. But I don't know why when he look at the red cell, he probably see all the blue cell. By the way, what the snake blood cell, what's the color? Ah, nobody knows that. Hey, biological science. Huh? What color? Huh? No color. Wrong. Okay, give me a. All right, anyway, that's a suspension. You have to find out. If I tell you, you will forget next day. Now everybody take the computer, their cell phone. I'll try to Google it now. Make impossible possible. When I went to United States, I don't even speak English. And so many years later, I also co-author about 40 books, about 300 papers. They said, wow, how you did it? I said, I'm not a genius. A lot of authors, they're genius. They can sit there in a week or two, they finish a book. I only write one page a day. Even you're so busy, you force yourself to write a page a day. Sometimes you really tire, so you just write bigger letter, one page. So you're happy. You set the goal, one page, I achieved just two letters. And so a year, how many pages you have now? Think about it. A little bit more. How many pages? Every 4 years, you have a leap year, right? Huh? And a quarter, okay. Here's that your badge. Okay. So, that's a book. And, of course, I met a lot of rich people, famous people, and holy people, and all kind of people. And all kind of leader, and politicians, citizens, and the world leaders. A lot of people say, I'm making possible possible. I get a lot of work. I'll probably collect more plaques and medals than anybody, any forensic scientist in the world. And all kind of work. And President of Taiwan gave me a Honorary Citizen Award. I said, what's the benefit for that? He said, half price for the zoo. I went to Turkey, they gave me this award. I tried to figure out what is that? And I still haven't figured out what kind of award is that, because all the letter is not in English. And of course, all different award. And I even got the Peace Award. That day, I look at all politicians, Kenya President, Cyprus Premier, Malaysia House of Speaker. I'm the only scientist. I say, you must have made a mistake. Another Henry Lee, you should give it to. No, the committee, you got the highest vote. I said, what's going on? They said, well, when you solve a case, those victims' family feel peace. I said, yeah, that's correct. Then they say, we admire you the most. You have the courage and integrity to stand up for those innocently convicted people, to speak for them. Now, they got peace. So I said, you're right. So I got my award. And a lot of magazines use me as a cover. A lot of newspaper use me as headline. What language is this? Hebrew. All right. Hosanna. Now, catch. All right. You're supposed to go forward, right? To catch the baseball. Now, how about this? Oh, no. How about this? What language is this? Huh?
Greek.
Greek, no. No. Polish. You know this. Malay. All right. Stella, you say that? Oh, single-handed. Wow. How about this?
Thai.
Thai, whoa. Who say Thai? You got it, okay. I even have my own movie. I'm a movie star too. I've been on all kind of television, big ass, small ass. From Larry King. One day I was invited to Fox. The two hosts, so bad, I said, move over, let me be in charge. So I sit in the middle. That night I have the highest rating. I even have my Broadway show and Las Vegas show. I even met a lot of movie stars. Oh, everybody know Michael Jackson, huh? Anybody know this guy? good guess. He got most Oscar than anybody else. But you are all too young. He passed away 3 years ago. We become good friends. Nobody knows. Huh? Not David. No. Anybody watch a movie, The Gun of Greece? A World War II movies? Oh, nobody knows. I forget about him. Anthony Quinn. Never heard that name. He's a famous actor. People forgot him so quick. How about this guy? Someday I tell you the story how I met him. I did not even know he's a famous actor. China, you might. 10 most well-known Chinese to Beijing. So, Yang Zemin, you know, right? Yeah. Li Zhendao. So, all famous, and you might meet too. So, the senior people, we all sit in the front of the bus, we talk, we joke, and have a young man sit in the back. I said, who is this guy? One person said, that's Di Pei. The person assigned to watch us. So now nobody talked to him. So that one night got to Tiananmen, the Hong Kong going to return to China, so have a clock, right? Dao Si Zhong. So they want us to go there, take a picture, some propaganda. So we get there, saw a lot of young girls cheering like crazy. I said, wow, that many people welcome us. Yang Zhenlin said, no. They welcome you, not us. I said, wow, no. not welcome me. They say, in United States, all the ladies are always cheering for you. I say, yes, they're all older ladies. Not the younger, you know, teenagers. They say, if they're not welcome you, which one here? I look around. Of course, nobody. We did not consider Deepay, right? So they say, you should step out of the bus first. I say, okay. So I step out of the bus, I raise my hand. Oh, they're crazy, cheering. And I thought, really, they welcome me. Oh, I said, oh, I have so many young fans in China, right? So I walk forward. All of a sudden, this young lady start charging. The police can't even stop them. They're yelling. And they pass me, they don't even stop. They're yelling, Liu Dehua, Liu Dehua. Turn out the Deepay is Liu Dehua. We get back on the bus. So one person asked, your name is Liu Dehua? Oh, yes. Lao Qianbei, that's what, yes. They call us Lao Qianbei. We're all old. One person said, what do you do for a living? Because we're all scientists or something. So asking, what you do for a living? He said, I'm in movie business. Oh, what kind of movie you play? Because we don't watch those movies. Do you sing? He said, yes. Oh, sing a song for us. So he's pretty nice. He's a really nice person. He entertained us, sing the song for us. I even got my television show even got 2 Kelly Awards. And of course, I even have my DVD. Is that cool? Did you get the set of my movie, right? That's it, now I talk. No. Now I spend, I have a lot of fans around the world. And from Indian to Saudi to all different countries. I even lead the charge here. And now I spend a lot of time travel around the world, lecture to the police officer, to the public, to law enforcement. And of course, I spend a lot of time with younger people. They are the future. You are the future of the world. If you spend time with your younger people, you feel young. A lot of people give me credit, say, this is my, they coded, that's me. What they say, I tell them, no, that's Professor Roe Crook in 1902, said, the more I help others to succeed, the more I succeed. That's so important for us. The professor basically helped the student to achieve to success. And people asking me why so happy every day. I'm so happy. Who can read this? Okay. You want to do that? Yes? Okay, what does it mean? Good. He must from China too, right? All right. I'm really lucky. I've been working with a lot of detectives around the world, 46 countries, 8,000 some cases now. Doesn't matter from Switzerland or Jerusalem or Russia or China, a homicide is a homicide. The investigation, basically the same. For the victim's family, the most important thing is to find out who are responsible for those and get the justice for the victim family. I've been involved in war crime, human rights at the United Nations request, 9/11, that time I still the commissioner. We went to New York to help. Also myself with 18 our DNA scientists tried to help them. Also, we work on a lot of historical case. You probably say, who cares? Who killed Kentucky? But the scientists, we have responsibility to find out the fact and truth. We work on also a rich and famous case from Kobe Bryant to Jean-Benet Ramsey. We work on a lot of political figure case from Kennedy assassination to President Chen Shui-Bian from Taiwan to Thailand premier. We work on a lot of other cases, famous cases. We also work on police shooting. We also work on serial killer, mass killer, all those cases. We also work on a natural or man-made disaster. Sometimes pretty important to identify those human remains, use scientific procedure such as dental record, fingerprint, anthropological study, x-ray, medical record, artificial intelligence, of course, blood DNA typing. And for example, TWA, we have to work on a lot of tissue and try to identify the individual. Many times, dismembering case and they dispose the body part in the ocean, then we have to try to figure it out and to link together. Of course, I also went to Kosovo, Croatia, Bosnia, to identify those human remains, thousands of the body. And of course, once we made identification and the parents break down, you have to try to comfort them. Communication is important. So you have to learn communication skill. I don't even speak their language, but there is something called universal language, love and care. And that's why we developed such good relationship with Croatia now. One of my students got PhD from me. He became a minister of education in Croatia, minister of science. And every so often I go back to Croatia lecture. I say 9/11, we, as I said, I'm OJ Simpson. We have to do a lot of analysis, but the most important piece of evidence is that three bloody fingerprints on Nicole's arm. They never collected, never even recognized, and washed it. The case remained unclear. That's so important at the crime scene. So Kennedy assassination on November 22nd, 1963. Kennedy just finished a lunch talk. His limo passed by Texas Book Deposit. On the sixth floor, a shot was fired. And Kennedy got killed. Lee Oswald was quickly arrested. Is Lee Oswald the only assassin? Or that's a political conspiracy? 50 years now. This year is the 50th anniversary. We still don't know. Because Lee Oswald was gunned down by Ruby. Second day. In 1998, Congress set up another committee asking me to look at all evidence, whether or not I have newer scientific way we can solve this puzzle. Also, I work on Vincent Foster case. That case, they think, changed the U.S. history because Vincent Foster was the White House counsel for Clinton, the most trusted person, Clinton's high school, college, and law school classmate. die in the park, single shot in the mouth. So my report now become a congressional document. Also work on Clinton, and Washington Post even have a cartoon said Dr. Lee was in White House look for evidence. Does that look like me? I'm much concerned than that, right? So all this, my Caucasian friends say, don't worry about it. How many Chinese ever become a color cartoon? You made it. I say, what that made it? They say, is he zipper up or zipper down? And that's the dress, Monica's dress. Here the semen stain. Of course, as a forensic scientist, you got to see a lot of things normal people don't get to see. You even go to White House to check the president's DNA. That's Clinton's DNA. So Clinton, first, he denies, I did not have sex with that woman. When DNA found out that's his DNA, he said, yes, I have a relation, but that's not sex. All right? So everybody asking me what president's DNA looks like, what's the ordinary people's DNA looks like. What the structure of DNA? A double helix. Oh, where's my slide? This disappeared. Okay. Clinton's DNA is the zipper down. Okay? So single-strand DNA. Of course, recently USA Today lists 25 events changed the world history. And when I look at that edition, found out 14 of those cases, 9/11, Katrina, OJ Simpson, Clinton, Oklahoma City bombing, death of Diana, Columbine massacre, 14 of those, I directly, indirectly involved. In my life, I never dreamed. I was born in that little city and grown up. Now the work even changed the world. Like a biological science, scientists, early days, never changed the world. But future, you guys going to change the world too. Today, biological science is so important. Early days, you don't need DNA or fingerprint. You just put the suspect in this wonderful machine, you make one more turn, he going to confess anything you wanted. Justice so quick, they just chop your head off. No appeal. Of course, this is totally inhumane. Now how police solve the work case, neighborhood canvassers use informer, surveillance, recording, interview, photo lineup. This is the chief medical examiner from Chicago. He looked like a child abuser. Dr. Cass Nelson, he's the director of Lillingrad Medical Legal Institute. He looked like a serial killer. The middle guy is a nice guy. Wait a second, my wife said I'm a lousy speaker. She wants to take over. You want her to talk? All right. Hey, Margaret, they want you to talk. I can sit down. She only can take picture. All right. Anyway, even with polygraph stress analysis, psychological evaluation, and hypnosis, microanalysis, we still cannot find out the person telling the truth or not. So 21st century, how we solve the case, image recording, image enhancement, artificial intelligence, data mining, time analysis, of course, forensic evidence, and crime scene reconstruction. Every speaker entitled 2 second commercial. That's one of the best book. Forensic science today now have so many different specialty now. And also the procedure from the scene to the lab to the examination is getting standardized. CSI said, what's so unusual? Every night by second commercial where they solve the case, take you so long. And of course, the CSI effect really changed the complexion of the physical evidence and the public opinion. CSI made us look so good, they think I can talk to dead people. Every day, every night, I try to talk to dead people, but they never talk to back to me. This case, I spent 4 hours with him, used 6 different languages. My sergeant took this picture. I got so mad, I gave him a finger. I said, no, I'm not giving him a finger. I tried to communicate with him through sign language. Indeed, at the crime scene have sign language. The location of the body, the condition of the body tells me that's a secondary crime scene. He was murdered someplace else, a dump on the shore. The soil material on the blue jean is different than the sand particle. Can you see that? I know the original scene is an organic rich soil surface. Rigors already set. Give me estimate time of the death. Needle mark on the arm, habitual of this individual. Livility, shift. I know body has moved. Pocket inside out, no wallet, possible motive. Trace evidence, saliva, hair, everything. Give me a scientific way to profile the suspect. Everything except the scene. You have to learn to read that language called silent language. Once in a while, so simple, I got to the scene. 14 detectives surround the body. Said, Dr. Lee, what happened to him? I say, that's elementary. He just got shot. Look at the bullet hole. We don't even have to do autopsy. They said, where can we find information? I said, call 838-0010. So the case solved. CSI, every episode is in the dark. Gives this mysterious feeling. Our case can be night, can be day. CSI, you never need a warrant. You can do anything. CSI, detective goes to scene, always bring a flashlight. Their light is so good. Shine the surface, everything pop up. When two detectives go to crime scene, they have two lights. When three detectives, they have three lights. Everybody have a light. We use a lot of light sources. We still cannot find evidence. And we even use copper laser. CSI, a copycat. I use this copper laser, the first one. We went to Taiwan, this shooting. The next week, CSI come up with copper laser, said, found all those evidence. Copper laser give you the trajectory, not finding the evidence. And of course, CSI walked to the scene. We walked to the scene, but we walked better, right? And at the scene, we line up for photograph. When I go to foreign country, same thing, I line up for photograph. CSI line up for photograph. How about Singapore? They line up for whatever you do, don't wear tight pants, okay? When you go to crime scene, you wear tight pants. Doesn't work. Hey, you like that? The only thing similar, I always emphasize in teamwork. So CSI, I'm glad they also emphasize in teamwork. But their team always say, man with a gorgeous lady, a man with a woman, man with a woman. That's their team. My team, always one man work, the rest are watching. If I go to Taiwan, one man work, the rest are watching. Recently, I was asked to investigate this cruise ship tragedy. We got to, on the cruise ship, get on this canopy. It's a heavy plastic cover, very slippery. I have my assistant, Joe, with me. He's about 20 years younger than me. We have a Miami homicide detective. He's about 30 years younger than me. Have a forensic scientist from Florida, 35 years younger than me. We got on the canopy. I was hoping one of the young person going to go to the edge of the canopy. That's pretty dangerous. If you don't careful, you're going to wind up in the ocean. Guess what three of them say? Dr. Lee, you go ahead. We're holding the rope for you. I have to crawl to the edge. They're holding the rope for me. Of course, when you become commissioner, you go to crime scene. Seven people lift the tape for you. Now, of course, from the scene, we discover some fiber. Those fiber, right away, now we can analyze it. Also can search the database. Speed up a lot now. Of course, we don't have CSI instrument. You put suspect's hair here, the suspect's picture popped up. You have name, social security number, address, everything. Look at my examiner and say, wow, I want that machine. CSI never have any stress. Middle of an explosion. What happened here? Huh? Okay. Hey, doesn't work anymore. Huh? Oh, middle of the explosion, they still investigate. My advice, middle of explosion, run for your life. When explosion over, come back to investigate. They never have to face the community or issues. And if you don't handle this issue correctly, you're going to have a riot in your hand, especially in the United States. A case involving a white police officer or minority decedent. Miami have that experience. New York, Newark, of course, Los Angeles have many times. Looting, burning, and in Taiwan, of course, demonstration. CSI, every time they solve a case, they got the hug and the kiss. I've been solving a lot of cases. No ladies kiss me yet. Once in a while, an ugly guy hugged me. And of course, when you go to San Francisco, be careful. Somebody want to kiss you. Evidence, of course, have morphological evidence, chemical evidence, you have firearm evidence, you have foreign material evidence, you have a pattern injury, you have a biological trace evidence, and we usually study grass, leaves, wood, plants, pollen, flower, insect, maggots, fungus, furs. Just any imagination of a material can be physical evidence. Of course, physiological evidence with blood, stain, hair, semen, all those. With serological evidence, actually start year 1904. Dr. Nanschneider invented ABO grouping. Then by 1940s, hemoglobin, HbA, HbCa, HbS, sickle cell. That time we thought we can determine the ratio group. Then 1960s, what happened here? That's your student or what? You don't know either. Oh, okay. Then, of course, come on DNA. DNA, anything, a new procedure, new way to analyze the evidence, quickly embarrassed by the public, say DNA is good. Even the judge come along, DNA is fine. So in 1998, DNA introduced in the United States. Just like anything else, once DNA introduced, all the commercial firm come along. Say 1 hour DNA, you can finish DNA in 1 hour. Let me say, you can make coffee. If you can make coffee, you can make DNA. Make us forensic scientists look so stupid. I still remember that time the lab director, I'm not the boss, not commissioner. The commissioner called me, when are we going to do DNA, Dr. Lee? I said, well, I'm ready. Because any new procedure, you have to do a lot of control, a lot of experiment. And not just say, something good, tomorrow we start implement. So person's life and liberty depends on some very shaky ground. So just like anything else, once accepted, after 6 months, now they say DNA cannot be used. Even the first one, a professor testified in a trial. He now says, he rejected. He said, I made a mistake. DNA is not unique. When you have those problems, how you solve it? So in the United States, you should have a committee to study. So the first committee was set by FBI. We study. They cheap. They just serve coffee. And this committee, of course, we study. We cannot come up with any solution. Yesterday, last night, I put this slide together. He already passed away. He retired. He's in jail. I'm the only one working. So that committee did not solve anything. So have a second committee, international committee. So we have Canadian chief serologist, we have a French guy, we have an FBI guy. So that committee, so we serve beer, right? So you achieve a little bit more, but you cannot solve the problem. So means need a bigger committee. So National Academy of Science took over. You have a couple Nobel Prize winner, and they serve meal and nice wine. But every committee need a minority token. That's me, the Chinese guy. And so we study. Who is this person? Anybody know who is this person? Huh? I'm not asking you. Nobody else know? Alex Jeffrey. Okay, you got the second one more. You can give any. You can even give to my friend here, right? All right, Alex Jeffrey. He's the first one introduced DNA into forensic work. Look at that, how young, how handsome he is. Look at me, how young, how handsome, right? So many years later, in between we met a couple of times in the meeting. Last year in India, have a DNA conference. They invite two speakers, keynote speakers. They did not tell me who is the other keynote speaker. I got to India, guess who is the other speaker? Alex Jeffrey. He said, Henry, you still look alike. Nothing changed. I said, Alex, you look so different. Can you see that? That's Jeffrey. Yes, I get a little older, but I'm still okay. I'm functioning well. He said, what's the secret? How you keep young? You have to feel young. Have to continue, move. You can't really say, I'm tired, I'm all. I say, another thing, I drink tea. Can you see that? You drink coffee. So he said, I have to change. He's going to drink tea now. That's why I have a good wife. Every day she makes some tea. Thank you, Margaret, make tea. I even wrote a book about DNA, but don't worry about it, that's a bad book. Don't buy it. DNA, why DNA was challenged? Because six issues: genetic issue, procedure issue, technical issue, matching issue, statistical issue, interpretation, and reconstruction issue. Genetically, of course, this issue resolved. Is DNA unique? Who said no? Who said no? All right, why? Identical twins have the same DNA. All right, catch, all right? Okay. Identical twins have same DNA. Also depends what type of DNA you're testing. If it's a mitochondrial DNA, all the siblings is the same. Of course, DNA now progress so much now, early days RFLP, later STR, now single nucleotide, basically repeat polymorphism. RFLP, early days, you need a lot of DNA. And envelope, you need less than, of course, STR, 4 to 6 base pair. You can do an analysis. DNA, technically, it's all standardized in the United States. And laboratory equipment, also standardized. And of course, statistical information, basically, you just calculate population genetics. And DNA, you can link a person, you can exclude, including a person, you can link a suspect. The most important thing is provide investigative lead. If you don't have a suspect with biological evidence, human identification, just now we talk about it, you can use DNA. And of course, you can use a person's toothbrush, wallet, or car, or key. You can get DNA out of it. And victim identification, especially skeleton remain or nobody case, for example, is this one person or two person here? Looks like two, but just one. Skin looked like the same, but skin looked like different, but this is exposed to sunlight. This is under the shade. And of course, we have to determine that's male, female. Female, male. Well, you can do DNA, XY chromosome, and of course, just now we talk about that, and you also can link to the suspect, right? And Kobe Bryant, you all know him? Yes? Okay. When he got his case, and the chief state attorney contacted me, can we help out? I said, no, I'm busy. I was in Denver lecture. They sent 4 detectives, kidnapped me. Took me, drove through mountain range and to there to exam. That's the evidence from DNA. Can DNA tell us that's a rape or not? No, DNA cannot. Only can say what's a semen, whether or not include a suspect, because her panty, and it's a mixture of DNA. So mixture DNA, the interpretation become difficult. Of course, this case I already show you here, is the regular DNA. What's the Clinton's DNA looks like? And of course, DNA, we can also exclude or including a suspect. The mother and the daughter was raped and killed. Body was buried. We're helping the Pennsylvania investigate this case in the victim's fingernail. We found some DNA linked to the suspect. Same thing, DNA can exclude a person. This individual was charged for the rape. He said, I did not do it, and judge found him guilty. He got really crazy. Judge said 18 years sentence. After 17 years, his wife kept sending letter to forensic scientists that my husband is innocent. Guess what? He in fact is innocent. DNA linked to somebody else. So DNA, of course, at the crime scene, you have to recognize potential DNA. Just like usual, one man work, the rest are watching. And if you don't know how to collect, you collect a lot of sample, all victims. All those work is useless. That's why it's so important to recognize the potential evidence. This case happened in Switzerland. The Switzerland Lausanne police chief is a good friend of mine. They don't have too many homicide cases. Probably just like Singapore, 8 to 20 homicide a year. But that year, they have a college student was murdered. So he called me, Dr. Lee, can you come over to help us? I said, no way, I'm busy. And he said, how about 1 week vacation in Switzerland? I said, still busy. I said, in Europe, a lot of experts. Oh, no, we want somebody from the United States. I said, United States, tons of experts. We want you. I said, no, I can't. He said, when can you come? I said, maybe next year. And so I got home. I saw my wife packing. I said, what, Margaret, what you doing? He said, the chief invited her to Switzerland for vacation. And chief even sweet the deal a little bit, say, all the chocolate you can eat. So she on her way to Switzerland, I have to carry the bag for her. Luckily, I went to Switzerland. Do you see 3 drops of blood on her leg? That's called vertical low velocity passive dripping, which means she already on the ground, blood subsequently dripping onto the surface. That become important. Only 2 possibilities. 1, suspect get injured. 2, you have a bloody knife, still have a lot of wet blood. So one way or other, you should do DNA. But most of the time, when pathologists or police officers get to the scene, they turn the body around. When you turn the body around, what happened with the evidence on the leg? Come, put in the body bag. Contaminate. Get to autopsy, they wash the body first down the drain. So this case was solved right away. Did the DNA search their national bank and get the hit. This is another case. If you collect a lot of blood stain here, useless. But that's 3 drop. Can you see that? That is different. So recognition is so important for scientists. When you do an experiment, research, you have to be able to recognize and spot the problem, the issue, and try to resolve it. Of course, you can link the cases, use data bank, serial rapist, serial killer. Like a lot of time, defense law attorney cross-examine, Dr. Lee, what's your experience in rape? I said, "Counselor, I haven't raped a single woman yet. But I do have a lot of experience. Each box is a rape kit. Look at how many rape kits we examined. Early days, if you don't have a suspect to compare, nothing we can do. Now, have a data bank. All those cases in data bank. So anytime have a person arrest a DNA, you can match. So you have to set up a sex offender data bank. Now today have so many different data bank and almost 1.5 million DNA profile. DNA, not only FBI have a CODIS, also local police department have a data bank. Like this one, we was able to link 3 different states from Maine and Massachusetts, Connecticut. A serial rapist was charged for the crime. This is the serial killer and 18 prostitutes was murdered. We was able to link together. So a lot of new emerging DNA technique, single nucleotide, robotic platform, also microbial DNA, and we also look at can we determine the age of the individual or ancestry of the individual. From the scene to the lab, to the courtroom, it's a continuous flow. So biological evidence is very important for our work. Many times, we do a lot of different examination and we can track with database. Now we even look at a so-called biometric database now, from retina, fingerprint DNA, to many other things. So with DNA, just like any other evidence, a scientist will have to be reliable and impartial. Unfortunately, in the United States, it's an adversary system. You only can represent one side. If I represent the prosecution, defense lawyer always say, "I'm biased." If I represent defense, same testimony, prosecution go to claim I'm a hired gun. Doesn't matter what you do. We talk about Kennedy assassination, Vincent Foster. Lesson learned from high profile case, don't get involved. Anytime high profile case, I usually receive 2 million letters. Now, that's before computer time. Email. Now the email, I don't even look at the email anymore. It's impossible. The mailman become my best friend. Dr. Lee, another 2 boxes. My secretary said, "Dr. Lee, what are we going to do?" I said, "Open up. If it's a check, let's keep it. If it's a bill, send it back." The war crime used DNA. Just now I mentioned a little bit about war crime. Just so many people got killed in this world. The biological evidence becomes so important. In 1993, the former Yugoslavia break up, so a lot of infighting, a lot of killing, a lot of mass grave. At the request of United Nations, Bosnia government, so we went there to help them. And of course, they sent a team of special task force. They're all big, tall people. I'm very short. First 5 minutes, I feel very in fear. Okay, I have to talk to them like this. 5 minutes later, I feel so great because that time they shoot each other. So you walk in between tall people, you don't get hit. It's really nice. So as an Oriental, you do have some advantage. Of course, we have to go dig. That's another mass grave. And digging, of course, you have to identify. Because they don't have dental record. They don't have hospital anymore. So we have to rely on the most primitive way, anthropological reconstruction. Once we narrow down to certain group, then we do DNA with their parents. So we do a lot of quite a bit different work. So one day we got a place called Corpus Plan. The commanding officer informed us here is a mass grave. But intelligence also indicates the body buried with live grenade and landmine. Because later they are afraid we're going to dig. They put landmine there. Four Caucasian, one Chinese, we went there. When we hear landmine, guess what? All five turn white. I think I'm a Caucasian too. I'm the shortest one. Everybody look at me. Dr. Lee, what are we going to do? I said, I don't know what you guys are going to do. I'm leaving. I said, Chinese have a very famous strategist, Sun Zi. Sun Zi Bing Fa. Anybody know that? 36计. Whoa, very good. Pepe, go give some autographed card. Eugene, you go to that side. Some give it to the back. All right. Anybody want wine? So you can raise your hand so they can give it to you. And of course, that's an international investigation. United Nations observer, human rights group, everybody watching. I'm the only Chinese. I can't really say I run away. We're going to lose face, right? Oriental, we can't lose our face. I said, let's dig. Now, if you dig the wrong place, you're finished. That's ending your career. So Dr. Baden went with me. He's the former chief medical examiner of New York. He's about 280 pounds. He drinks a lot of beer. Can you see that? A big beer belly. He started telling everybody, in United States, they refer me as king of the crime scene. So he said, Dr. Lee is king of the crime scene. Everybody should listen to his order. I said, Michael, stop the bullshit. Just sit down. I said, you're too big. If you step on something, we're all going to get killed. He said, oh, yes, yes. He right away sit down. So 2 minutes later, I said, Michael, move to next spot to sit. So he got up, moved. So I start digging the area he just sat. When I finished, I said, Michael, get up and move another spot. So he got up and moved. I start digging. This goes to 6-7 times. He said, what you doing? I said, 280 pounds, sit down, get up, nothing happened. It's safe to dig. He said, you Chinese so smart. I said, no, I'm the dumbest one. And so we found a lot of body. And 2-3 years ago, the president wanted to give me a medal to thank us for our work. The president have the eyesight problem. This medal have a long needle. Keep pushing. I can't even yell out because I'm going to lose face again, right? I try to do this. He keep pushing. So to get the medal, be careful. And you first ask the person, are you going to have a good eyesight? If not, I do myself. And Tiger. You all heard tiger problem, right? Tiger, I know nothing about tiger. When I went to China, Beijing lecture, they come to see me and say, have this biggest debate. The whole scientific community, the whole population, dividing group. One say, that's a genuine tiger. Others say, no, that's a fake. And every day they have papers and scientific debate. And can you look at it, Dr. Lee? I said, I know nothing about tiger. So when I finished, I went to Guilin. And they followed me to Guilin. When I finished from Guilin, I flew to Bangkok. They followed me to Bangkok. When I finished Bangkok, I went to U.S. Guess what? They showed up in U.S. Please, they might feel bad. I said, okay, take a look. This is the tiger. They took a series of photos. So I took the first one and the last one. Made this. You look at it. In between, there quite a few minutes. Is the tiger moved? No, tiger did not move at all. What moved? The leaves. You say, that's impossible. The tiger, the tongue stick out, the ear. If an animal in the wood, usually they have to shake it a little bit or move a little bit. This tiger, the tongue just sticking out. I said, wow. And the leaf, I said, how that's happened? So make a long story short, so I went to zoo to visit the tiger. I said, how you guys distinguish yourself? Stripe. That's genetics. Who says stripe? You say stripe. Here, she already got the... Huh? She want to give a husband. How many husbands you have? Huh? Five? You have five husbands? All right. So the stripe, just like the fingerprint. Every tiger is under genetic control. So stripe, you have this loops, lines. So this is a tiger in a wood. Chinese people, so smart. On the website, they found a calendar. They sent me the calendar. The color, of course, different. Any Photoshop can change that. But you look at a two short line, a circle, two more short line. This is called bifurcation, bifurcation, a big hook, a big hook. You say, ah, this two tiger looks alike. They must be twins. So what we did a ridge analysis. We found 14, all 14 ridges is identical. In addition, we start counting the whiskers. They have same amount of whiskers. So my conclusion, the tiger is a paper tiger. And of course, after a trial, he was convicted. We tried to figure out. I say, how he did it? Turned out, we thought he used a sophisticated scientific way. Guess what? He just took the calendar, cut the paper, tiger out, put on a piece of cardboard, cut the shape, take to the wood, different location, same piece of cardboard. That's why the leaf is changed. The tiger is still the same. And he doesn't want to throw that tiger out. He hide behind the cabin. Police search his house for the tiger. So he just out of the jail now. He just declared he found another tiger. But this time he forgot to take the camera. Did not have any photograph. He afraid that's going to find out. We did that before. OJ case, what's wrong with OJ Simpson case? Look at this 2 drop of blood. If from same day, same time, same temperature, same receiving surface, what is 2 drop blood supposed to look like? The same. Can you see that? One is wet, one is dry. Cannot be. Later found EDTA in the drop. EDTA is what? A preservative. It's not supposed to be in human circulation. Later found out the chief detective took O.J. Simpson's blood. Instead of book it in the evidence room, he put it in his own pocket. Back to crime scene for 2 hours. He testified, he said, that's the standard procedure. No police department in the world, you can put the suspect blood and bring back to the crime scene. Later found out 1.5 cc missing. So, of course, from there, the jury decided not to convict O.J. Simpson. And they sell in the seat while I testified for charity. And they bid $50,000 a seat, testify, watching me testify. Of course, the prosecution have to find something to attack me. They cannot attack my credential nor my evidence. They found my ruler. They took my ruler to National Bureau Standard and compare. 3 PhD scientists compare my ruler. Found my ruler is 1,000th an inch short. 1,000th an inch short. Middle of the trial, the DA pulled a ruler out. Dr. Lee, is that your ruler? I see my name on it. I cannot say Eugene Lee, misspelling. It's not my ruler. I say, yes, sir, that's my ruler. Do you know your ruler 1,000 inch short? I say, I don't. Does that make your scientific examination wrong? I say, of course not. Why? I say, read my report. Approximately 5.2 inches, approximately 6.3 inches. After 50 years working forensic field, I know how to cover my ass. So, we never give you exact. Always say similar, consistent, maybe, could be. So Judge Ito, the presiding judge, excellent answer, move on. But the DA doesn't want to give up. They want to beat me harder. Say, you are a scientist. Scientists have to be exact. I said, counselor, give me a break. $1.49, I bought it. If you're really unhappy, talk to them. Okay, who make the ruler? Judge Ito said, excellent, excellent. And so, judge want a ruler, so I have to give him a ruler. He collect all this memorabilia. The prosecutor want a ruler. I have to give her a ruler. Defense attorney want a ruler. Then next morning, newspaper, highlight of the trial. Dr. Lee have a ruler, 1,000 inch short. American people is funny. Anything they collect. I got 14,000 requests for ruler. People sending $100 and $50 for a little ruler. My wife say, you're stupid. I said, why? She said, if you make 10,000 ruler, now we're rich now. 1 millionaire. So one day after trial, my computer crime supervisor ran to my office, said, Dr. Lee, you have to check the eBay. I said, I don't have time to check the eBay. You have to look at this one. O.J. Simpson ruler, $495. Somebody stupid enough bought a ruler. Now when I go to check in the airport, they say credit card, I take the ruler out. I check in the hotel, payment, myself payment, I give them a credit. So now we see who is the lucky person get this ruler. Now 6 o'clock, okay? We stop in here, and we have a lot of other cases. Some other day we're going to talk about. So who going to get the ruler? Whose birthday is today? Oh, we have somebody come over. Come over. All right. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Happy birthday. Give her a hand. Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you for coming. Eugene, your turn. We still have one autograph. All right.
All right. As I mentioned, Dr. Lee is able to go on for hours and talk about all his interesting cases, but that's all the time that we have today. By the way, do you all know how old is Dr. Lee? Right, he's 75 years old and has more energy than most of us. Well, to thank Dr. Lee for his time and for giving us the presentation, Prof. Tan would present a token of appreciation to Dr. Lee.
Thank you very much.
Hey, Eugene, come in.
Thank you, thank you. Is this ticking like a bomb or what?
And also we have a token of appreciation for Mrs. Lee. Yeah, maybe talk to you. Yeah, maybe.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Lee.
All right. Ask my cousin, Margaret Shea, any question? The answer. Margaret, say hello to everybody.
Our NUS Forensic Science alumni, if you want to have a group photo with Dr. Lee, quickly come down now. The NUS Forensic Science alumni.
Oh. Alumni?
Yeah.
Oh, 去年你有那个大学毕业。